Evening, everyone. It's time to start our meeting, so we all call our St. Croix County Board of Supervisors to order. It's 5 o'clock on June 2nd. And at this time, we don't have anybody here, so we'll just stand and have a moment of silence for the I think now we'll have the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Cindy, can we have a roll call? One supervisor isn't here, Supervisor Brinkman. I heard from him earlier. I think he'll be here. So, okay. At this time, we're open for any public comment. Do we have any public comment this time? Any public comment at this time? I don't see any public comment, so we'll move on to our consent agenda. Do we have a motion to approve the consent agenda? Supervisor Babbitt, motion, seconded by Supervisor Berkey. Are there any additions or corrections to it? Any discussion? There's no discussion. We're ready to vote. Oh, Supervisor Babbitt.
There we go. I just wanted to say, our last meeting was quite lengthy, as everyone knows, and I thought the minutes were presented very well for a meeting that had so much content to it. I wanted to thank Cindy for that, because the meeting minutes were very accurate and thorough, and I think did a good job of summarizing all that very hard work we did last time. So Okay. Kudos to Cindy on the minutes.
Supervisor Novotny?
I did find one error in the minutes.
That's my job.
It was a vote. Instead of yay, it was nay. And I would have to try to locate it, but it's one of the votes
Okay. Got
reversed.
So okay.
I'll research it.
Any other discussion? No other discussion. I'll vote on it then at this time. All yeses, 18 yeses, I should say. The presentations we're coming up on now, I'm going to ask the supervisors that if it's all right if we switch these a little bit and go and take out of order and put number one down on the bottom and take two and three first and then take one. If that's all right with everybody, we'll make that change. Is that okay with everyone? Okay, we'll make that change then. So we'll start out with the DNR Secretary Award for Clarence Buck-Malik then.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. They were able to bring that up on the screen. Thank you. This is recognition by the St. Croix County Board of Supervisors for one of our former board members, Buck Malik, who was recently recognized by the State Department of Natural Resources for his efforts in the area of conservation and just overall great stewardship of county resources, land and water and air. And those of you that have worked with Buck over the years know that this is a very well-deserved award, and I think we all recognize Buck Malik as one of St. Croix County's finest when it comes to stewarding our natural resources. And so when the State Department Secretary honored Mr. Malik with this award, we thought it would be a good idea to invite Buck back to the County Board of Supervisors and recognize him for this award. I'd like to, Dan Bauman could not be with us this evening from the department, but Melissa Sparrow-Lean is here on behalf of the Secretary's office, and I'd like to call on Melissa at this point, who will say a few words, and then I have something to present to Buck. Missy, thanks.
Thank you, appreciate the opportunity to be here. I'm a wildlife biologist with the Department of Natural Resources working out of the Baldwin office, and my job really is as the project coordinator of the Western Prairie Habitat Restoration Area. And this is one of the things that many of you may know that Buck was very instrumental in getting started. It was started in 1999. It's a large landscape scale project, prairie project. And luckily, we've had Buck behind us the whole time, and we're hoping to grow the HRA and gain more prairie acres and wetland restoration acres. And I've only been here a couple years myself in the area, and very quickly I realized that this is one important guy when it comes to the conservation world in St. Croix County. He's involved in so many different organizations, it's just amazing. So I just want to read, and I'll keep this quick, my summary of my nomination is a page long, and I won't read it because it's just too long. So you guys all know all the things he's been involved with, but let me just read the last paragraph, because kind of sums things up. It said, Buck truly is the pedestal that supports the umbrella of conservation partnerships in St. Croix County and surrounding communities. His work is supportive of the mission of the DNR, and for his involvement with all these organizations and many others, and for his passion and unending drive in his environmental leadership and willingness to partner with others to create community awareness on the protection of prairies, wetlands, and rivers, Buck Malik is a hero to many of us in St. Croix County and very much deserves this award. Thank you.
Thank you, Melissa. So, Buck, can you come on up? And in token of our appreciation, and maybe you want to say a few words to the county board, but you know the drill. Here it is, a certificate of recognition. This certificate is presented to Clarence Buck Malik in recognition of your dedication and service to St. Croix County. Our sincere gratitude is extended to you this second day of June, 2015. It's signed by myself and Roger Larson, the county board chair. So thank you, Buck, and it's great to see you
thank
again.
Thank you, Pat.
Appreciate it. Everything you've done.
Please. This is embarrassing enough. You're very kind. You're generous in your applause and your approbation. And please understand that I do value your opinion and your respect. That's a delight to me. I'm sorry to say I'm that vain that I enjoy it. And that's fine. But we need to understand that. My name is just an example of other people, and as you know, nothing happens by individuals. It's when we work together in teams and small groups and other things like that that it happens. So I'm the example that was chosen to represent the many wonderful people that I've been able to work with, professionals and the agencies, you know, the DNR, the Fish and Wildlife Service, and others, who are folks who have dedicated their lives and careers to things that matter to us all and have taken the time and the work to become educated in specific details about how to make things happen on the land to assist nature rather than tear it apart. I thought I might say what causes me to be to value conservation and willing to work on it. At age 12, I had a conversion experience, and I became a Christian. And from an early age, it seemed to me that I identified that we have essentially two duties once we are freed of the burden of guilt and sin that is our natural state. One is the duty of care to other people. And much of what you do is directly related to that, you know, as you are seeing that the less fortunate members are cared for and things like that. And the other is a kind of partnership with the creator of this creation in the care of the world. Personally, I think that our mainline churches don't devote enough attention to that, that it was probably assumed in earlier eras when people were closer to the ground, when people were used to killing their own meat, growing their own crops, and such like that. It was just a natural state that you worked with nature. And so our Homo sapiens, you know, have been around for, well, we don't know exactly how long, but for at least the last 200,000 years. And we generally did not make significant permanent changes to the land. We did generally not, our forebears did not exterminate species. Now, Aldo Leopold, that famous Wisconsin professor who articulated some of the principles that work for game management and other things in working with the whole idea of ecology, made a trip to Israel and noted that, gosh, that land that once was described as a land of milk and honey, right? Now needs intensive agriculture, needs irrigation, needs fertilizers to make it sustain the population of the people who live there. What happened between then and now? Well, when Leopold went there, we lost some of the connection about stewardship of the land, those people did. And getting it back is difficult. He, in another place, he said, you know, one of the first rules of tinkering is don't lose any of the parts. If you're taking apart a watch to make it work better or something, don't lose any of the parts. Now we realize because of the invasion of invasive species, of aggressive species of plants or animals or insects or whatever, we also need to be very careful about not adding parts. When you take that watch apart and you're going to put it back together, or an engine or whatever, don't introduce new parts to the thing or we'll really, really foul it up. So we all have lots of challenges. They have to do with clean water and clean air and the invasion of the invasives, trying to get back just a tenth of the prairie that was in St. Croix County, Pierce and Polk, before the first settlers came is all important. And there's a role for each of us. Everybody can do what they do best and what they like and what turns them on, and together, cumulatively, we can do better and we will. And for those of you who aren't fully busy this coming Saturday morning, you can join Agnes and me at Homestead Park if you have the slightest interest in teaching kids to fish. Okay, 9 to 11 at Homestead Park, the county park. In fact, you don't even have to buy a park sticker. It's free admission that day to the county parks. But we could use your help putting worms on hooks and stuff like that. That's where it begins. Again, thank you so much for this honor. And it's way over the top, but I thank you for it anyway. Yep.
Thank you, Buck. Now we'll move on to our West Central Wisconsin Regional Planning Commission report, and we have Lynn Nelson here.
Good evening. My name is Lynn Nelson, and I am the Executive Director of the West Central Wisconsin Regional Planning Commission. I'm here tonight with Beth Waldhart, and Beth and I hope to do a couple of things. First of all, I am going to give you a brief overview summary of the Regional Planning Commission and some of the work that we've been doing in St. Croix County. Then I'm going to turn it over to Beth so that she can bring you up to date on some new developments that have occurred within the Regional Business Fund. The Regional Business Fund is a nonprofit organization that runs the Regional Consolidated Community Development Block Grant Business Loan Pool, and staff from the Regional Planning Commission administer that program. We've recently received word from the Department of Housing and Urban Development and the Wisconsin Department of Administration regarding some changes that could be occurring to that pool, and you also have a resolution on your agenda a little bit later that relates to that as well. So Beth will provide you with an update on that and talk a little bit about the resolution and what that's about. So our overall goal in doing all of this is St. Croix County is a member of our region and it's a member of our organization. And so I feel like it's really important for you to know about the projects that we're working on in your county, but I also want to make our services at the front of your mind so that if you have a problem or a project that our organization comes to mind and you think we could call them and they might be able to give us some direction or help as we try to work through this issue. So those two things is what we're hoping to achieve tonight. So first of all, just a few words on our organization. So the West Central Wisconsin Regional Planning Commission is a multi-county planning agency covering seven counties, including St. Croix, Barron, Chippewa, Clark, Dunn, Eau Claire, and Polk counties. Our overall goal is to assist units of government in planning for the social, physical, and economic well-being needs of the region. We do this by providing technical assistance, advice, and services directly to units of government, but also by working on issues that occur at a regional level. So our region consists of seven counties, 25 cities, 42 villages, and 161 towns. That's a total of 235 units of government. So while all of those units of government have individual problems and needs that need to be addressed, and we as a regional organization are there to assist with those types of individualized needs, there are also problems and opportunities that occur at a regional level. We can help you to pool together to address those issues, and we can also help you to learn from each other as other areas experience similar problems. You have a packet of information in front of you, and it includes one handout that looks like this. And it's a review of some of the projects that we worked on in 2014. Pages 2 and 3 focus on programs that cover the entire region, and the last page focuses more on projects that are specific to St. Croix County. So individual units of government within your county that we assisted with different types of consultation or projects that we worked on. I'd like to just highlight 5 projects that we've worked on as samples of the types of work that we're doing or that we could do for you. So the first 3 relate to projects that we've worked on with individual units of government. The first example is work that we've done with the City of New Richmond. So in 2014, the City of New Richmond adopted a capital improvements program. It included a whole variety of projects that they either needed or wanted to accomplish for the year in a prioritized order. So they called us and said, would you be willing to sit down with us and go over this list? So we can talk about ways that we might be able to approach the different projects. Are there funding sources that we might not be aware of? And how can we mix those types of funding sources? So 2 people from our staff went up there, sat down with the staff, and project by project, we went through their list, talking about what could be involved, the funding sources. And I think that's sometimes an overlooked service that we have to offer, in that it isn't contract work, it's a service that we provide at no cost to any unit of government. Just advice and consultation, capacity that we have within our organization to assist with those types of projects. So the second example is some contract work that we did. We assisted the town of Somerset in updating their comprehensive plan. We had assisted the town in completing their comprehensive plan in 2003. According to state statute, the comprehensive plans are recommended to be updated every 10 years, so it was time for them to update their comprehensive plan. Their desire to do that was also driven by growth in the area, the St. Croix Crossing, and their desire to make their plan come in line with the county's farmland preservation plan, as well as some zoning changes that were occurring. So that was a project that was completed recently. It was started in 2014, and we recently completed that. Chris Strait worked with the town on that work. A third example is actually not on your list and something that we're just starting to work on, but I wanted to mention it because it's a project we're really excited about, and that is working with St. Croix County on a bike and ped plan. So as you're aware, the county receives a large grant to put together that type of plan through an application to the Department of Transportation through the Transportation Alternatives, or TAP, program. So the county put out an RFP, and we replied to the RFP in partnership with a private consulting firm called Tool Design Group. So we had worked on your previous plan and feel like we have some pretty good knowledge of your county and the what's going on locally. And Tool Design Group brought together with our skills, architectural and engineering capacity that we don't have. So together we put together a proposal and were awarded that contract. So it's a really exciting project. I think you're probably all excited about it too. We'll be starting to work on that one soon. So that's a really great project that we'll be working on with the county. I have two other examples of projects that are a little bit more regional in nature, in that they cross jurisdictional boundaries or have benefit beyond your county. And the first one is the St. Croix Valley Incubator Project. There is a summary sheet in your packet about that project. It's a project that we've worked on with the folks from River Falls, primarily the University of Wisconsin River Falls, the City of River Falls, and the River Falls Economic Development Corporation, along with other partners such as the St. Croix County Economic Development Corporation, Extension, and a wide variety of other people, looking at what could we put in place to assist businesses in the area, trying to pull resources from the university and from other organizations and connect them to businesses in the area. And the group decided that the best way to do that was to construct a business incubator. And so the Regional Planning Commission assisted them with the preparation of a grant application that was submitted to the Federal Economic Development Administration. That grant requested $1.4 million in grant funding towards the project. It was submitted in April, and we found out in earlier May that it had not been funded, that they were recommending that a few things be changed, and we'll be resubmitting that in June, on June 12th. So that's looking very positive. I think it's a project that EDA is very interested in. There are a lot of partners, and that's really something that they're looking for. So that's something you can be looking forward to hearing about. Hopefully in July, a decision will be made on that, at least as far as the EDA funding component. And then the last regional example is another item that's in your packet, and that's our Farm Fresh Atlas. So every year since 2011, we have put together the Farm Fresh Atlas. It's inclusive of 19 counties in west central Wisconsin, and a really great way to promote farmers and farmers markets throughout the entire region. And you'll notice if you look in it this year, there's quite a few St. Croix County farms in there. So that's been a really popular publication in your county. So that's a snippet of some of the things we're doing. We're doing lots of other things. They're included on your summary sheet, and we've got a lot of other 2015 activities occurring as well. So with that, I am going to turn it over to Beth, and she will provide you with an update on the Regional Business Fund.
Thank you, Lynn, and good evening. I'm usually coming here on an annual basis to talk about all the great activity that the Regional Business Fund has been doing in St. Croix County with the businesses we've been assisting. But tonight I'm going to be talking about the recent decision that HUD, through the Department of Administration, has let us know. And what that is, and hopefully you've been getting my updates and my summary information all along, but HUD has declared that the process through which we took to defederalize the funds back in 2007, although they had at the time provided us the direction on how to defederalize the funds, does no longer follow HUD rules and regulations. And what that means is that in the past, we had been able to lend out the dollars for construction purposes without having to follow Davis-Bacon wage rates. It meant that we could do the facade loan program throughout the region to improve the facades of the businesses that are located in the historic downtowns. We were able to do a microloan program, which helped new businesses start up with a $25,000 seed money with no matching funds required. And the funds could be used to support job creation regardless of the pay of that particular job. So, and also regardless of who was applying for those positions. Because now with the federal requirements, it means that the funds need to be targeted to low to moderate income individuals. So it greatly restricts the depth and breadth of the businesses that the fund is able to reach, and really has caused the fund to be shut down. So we found out about this on April 1st of 2015, and from that date, we've been working with our local, state, and federal legislators on a path to try to get the decision reversed. And since the decision was at HUD, we needed to work through our federal legislators for advocacy. And Tammy Baldwin stepped up to the plate and drafted a letter to HUD, and that has since resulted in HUD allowing for a 30-day window in which they're going to be reviewing their decision that they made. And we are in the process right now of gathering the information to provide to HUD to show that although according to the current interpretation of the rules and regulations, there may be some things that we didn't do, although we did exactly as we were instructed back in 2007, but it follows very, very closely to the new understanding of what those regulations are. So we have the packet of information gathered, the letter has been drafted, we are anticipating sending this packet of information out directly to HUD tomorrow. And the 30-day window expires around June 13th. So we're hoping that with this information, with the detail of information that we've been able to provide to HUD, that they will offer a more favorable ruling and allow us to continue on as a defederalized fund. The other portion that we've been doing is gathering support from all of our partners within the economic development field, as well as the municipalities and in the 8-county region that we cover, which is the same as Regional Planning Commission, but we also cover Pierce County. So we have reached out to our counties and our municipalities to draft a resolution to support the defederalized status of the Regional Business Fund, and that resolution is on your agenda later this evening. So what the agenda, what the resolution states is basically gives the rundown of what the Regional Business Fund has done, the challenges that we're facing, and that St. Croix County supports our status as a defederalized fund. So I'd be happy to answer questions about that specifically when the resolution does come up on your agenda. But both myself and Lynn are here to answer any questions you may have about the Regional Planning Commission or the work that the Regional Business Fund has been taking on these past 2 months.
Are there any questions? No questions at this time? Okay. Thank you, Lynn and Beth.
Thank you.
This time we'll move on to the 911 infrastructure project, phase two funding. Steve.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen of the county board, members of the public protection and administration committees, and Mr. Thompson, county administrator. Thank you for your ongoing support of the Emergency Support Services Department, and in particular, this project, phase two, as we call it. It is our hope through our past briefings and this summary presentation tonight that we can give you a better understanding of the need for this project and how we reach the cost figures to date as the county steps forward to take on this long overdue upgrade of its dispatch center and emergency communication system. And Mr. Chairman, if you will indulge me for one moment, I'd appreciate it. I think everyone in this room recognizes the county's number one asset is its employees. Nowhere is that more evident to me than those who serve in the Emergency Support Services Department. During the last year, during a few absences of the prior director, and then after his departure and before my arrival, the men and women of this department stepped up, filled in, and worked together to keep the county's emergency services operations running uninterrupted. I'd like to particularly recognize Terry Anderson, the Emergency Communications Coordinator, for his general supervision of the Emergency Support Services Office during those times and his involvement in implementing phase one and now the first parts of the phase two upgrades, as well as his ability to keep the 911 dispatch center on an even keel during those rocky times. Kristen Saylor, the emergency management coordinator who pitched in with Terry to help run the office. Steve Bonneman, the lead technical communicator, telecommunicator, who's been instrumental in keeping this system together that we're going to talk about in a moment. And Janet Smith, who keeps the office running every day, regardless of the pressing emergencies. And of course, our emergency management program specialists and our emergency dispatchers who professionally handle each and every incident in this county 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I've never heard a complaint or a gripe from any of these employees about the long hours, the night meetings, or even the middle of the night calls. In fact, when I arrive on the scene at an emergency at 2 o'clock in the morning, I usually find Terry and Steve Bonneman setting up the communications van and already cracking jokes. I wish I could take credit, but I cannot. These folks were here before I arrived and are symbolic of the high caliber employees that you've hired. Thank you for indulging me to recognize them as some of the finest public safety professionals in the world. And now to the public's business of public safety. I have a PowerPoint presentation. A few of you have seen parts of this. It gets amended a little. The crux of it is relatively the same. But to keep you awake, there'll be a final exam on which slide is which. So here we go. There are a number of slides. The most important slide is perhaps the first one here and the last one that you'll see tonight. I think the first one here tells you a little bit about how the dispatch center was set up. Some of you may remember, some of you were obviously not here, but it was a battle. The centralized dispatch center was something that was put in motion by the county board in the late 1970s, but took some time to get off the ground and convince all the municipalities in this county that the county could run a consolidated central dispatch center in Hudson and save them money. The intent was economies of scale. The purpose of the dispatch center, besides having professional staff, was to free up money to maintain and replace capital items as their useful lives expire. We wanted to avoid the duplicate purchase of expensive equipment, and we thought that the cost of large capital could be distributed over a larger base of beneficiaries. In effect, centralized dispatch would reduce operating costs. However, over the 36-year history of the dispatch center, we've frankly fallen down a little on the job. During those 36 years, no municipality within St. Croix County has had to expend any funds for PSAP operations. Not a dime to the county. It was decided early on when the dispatch center opened in 1979 that the county would pick up the tab. It made more sense to have the county do it on a countywide basis than trying to bill back individual municipalities. In agreement to this, although it may sound odd, even though we weren't billing them, we also agreed to use the county's capital to improve the Emergency Communications Center as time went on. Unfortunately, as you can see, that really did not happen. The county made one moderate upgrade to its communication system in 1994, and its first extensive upgrade to the actual physical plant, the dispatch center itself, in 2013. Something we called phase one. But I'm not sure I can make it any more clear. There's been no substantial radio upgrade in this county in 36 years. We are in effect holding this together with paper clips, bubble gum, and rubber bands. My staff are buying parts off eBay to keep equipment working. This is the original dispatch coverage from 1979 to 1994. Some of you, it might be easier on the big screen, and I don't want to poke anybody in the eye with this laser printer that Janet got for me. Those are tower sites, as you can see on the screen in front of you. When we started dispatch in 1979, we had a tower in Hudson on the Wisconsin Street water tower, one at County Road N, it's gone, one at the Hammond Highway Shop, that's still there, and one up in Emerald Township, that is also gone. What occurred along the way is, in 1994, they expanded those tower sites a little, but in effect, as I told the admin committee a couple weeks ago, my friends on the east end of the county will tell you it was like rearranging chairs on the deck of the Titanic. We moved, we lost the County Road N tower. We picked up the Pierce County tower that we share with Pierce County. That will be a topic for discussion shortly. Emerald Tower was dismantled, and we moved a little further east and built a tower in Glenwood City, and we added the health center. That will also be discussed in a moment. But as you can see, there are still vast areas of the county that were not covered. The phase two goals are intended to remedy, obviously, some of that. In the dispatch center, we're implementing what's called Next Gen 911. In fact, it goes live tomorrow. That will allow the transmission, eventually, of more visual data, text to 911 type information, and other improvements in the 911 system. We're going to upgrade our radio consoles. We're going to improve our mass notification. And if I can digress for one moment about that, we currently have something called City Watch. Some of you have heard about it. Some of you have experienced it. Some of you will recall during the prison escapee in New Richmond a few weeks back, that it didn't exactly perform well. The problem is it only distributes calls and messages to 16 lines at a time. Well, when you're trying to cover an area, it just keeps going and going and going. We had actually broken down our command van in the New Richmond Hospital parking lot, and we're on our way home, and that thing is still dialing and sending messages out to about 5 in the morning, I believe. It's very inefficient because it doesn't reach people well. We had, was it the flood warnings? It took 8 hours. We had some flood warnings a while back before I arrived. They used City Watch. It took 8 hours to get those messages out. Code Red bought City Watch, and they're going to abolish it. The new system will distribute calls at a rate of 2,300 messages at one time. So we can cover a vast area very quickly. Now, I don't know all the details yet of Code Red. I'm kind of excited to see. We're going to go live with Code Red on July 1st of this year. We're going to see also about whether there are other abilities in there to make notifications. I'm going to be very candid with you folks, because that's usually the way I call it. Our job in the dispatch center, especially when it gets busy, is to ensure that the emergency services are handled. It's very difficult to make notifications, whether it's to you folks or even to the county administrator. Sometimes we have to hustle to let him know, and frankly, sometimes Mr. Thompson doesn't learn of events till well after they're over, because frankly, we just didn't have the time to let him know. But usually, once the dust settles, we'll send the county administrator a message. The dispatchers are frankly just too busy to be sending messages out. One of the things we're looking at with Code Red is the possibility of interface with something called IPAWS. It is what it sounds like, I-P-A-W-S, IPAWS. It is an interface to allow greater distribution of a message to fill up social websites, our social media pages, things of that nature. These are things we're going to learn along the way. Our goal is to have a better product after July 1st, but if you'll bear with me, it's going to be a learning curve for those of us in the dispatch center as well to figure out how it's going to be used, how the distribution will go out, and who will be notified. It will be, as the technology expands in this county and in this world, it can't all be on the backs of the dispatchers. They just don't have that kind of time. So with Code Red, as I understand it, and correct me, Mr. Anderson, if I'm mistaken, the burden's going to rest on the users, our citizens, except with exception. There are other ways to get messages out that need to be pushed out. But with certain incidents, those who have signed up, gone on our website after Code Red becomes active in July, for those who sign up, they'll be able to get messages as we send them out. So I won't digress anymore on Code Red because we're not fully aware of its capabilities, but I wanted to let you know that we are certainly aware of the problems with City Watch, and as part of the phase two upgrades, we're going to go to hopefully a much better system. And speaking of much better systems, we've already implemented emergency medical dispatch, and we are utilizing it. It has proven to be a much better response for our dispatchers and our emergency medical service providers. We obtain more information and assist them in dispatching EMS units out. Out in the field, there's going to be obviously additional changes, and these are the most significant changes. What you see on this screen is really what we're talking about in terms of the crux of the phase two upgrade. And when we talk about no substantial changes or upgrade in 36 years, here it is. We're going to be adding towers, antennas, and shelters. We're going to add fixed VHF, which is very high frequency radios, and microwave radio equipment. We're going to be adding vehicle repeaters to the sheriff's patrol vehicles. And we'll talk about that in a moment when we look at a couple of the maps. And communications van upgrades. We have a 16-year-old communications van that is somewhat getting towards the end of its useful life. So we need to look at what's in the best interest of the county from an efficiency standpoint. So those are the changes and goals that we hope to achieve as part of the phase two upgrade. I thought I'd throw this in. I'm hoping that it's in your packet of information. It was kind of a last minute addition because we just got it yesterday morning. This is the Emergency Medical Service, EMS. This is the Emergency Medical Service calls for service in 2014. As you can see, I'm going to use my pointer over on this map. The circles, the bigger the circle, the more calls for service. In 2014, our county EMS providers responded to over 9,500 calls in the county. A substantial number of calls for a county our size. You can kind of see where they are in the Hudson area there, both kind of to the south and to the east, somewhat in the Roberts, and also where you'd expect in each of the population centers, Hammond, Baldwin, Woodville, Glenwood City, a few up here in the Forest Island area, New Richmond, Star Prairie, and Somerset. I think it kind of goes without saying that when you have population centers, that's where your calls are going to be, and that's pretty much where our calls are. You can also see calls in other parts. You can see up here, not sure, Roger, is that Cedar Lake Speedway up there? It's been a while since I've been up there. But as you can see, there are obviously calls out in the county. St. Joe Township is somewhat unique because it has a fire department and a rescue squad, but it's literally the only municipality in the county that I'll say doesn't have a population center. I don't know if Holton is considered a population center, but for the most part, St. Joe Township, their fire department is located at E&V. That's certainly not a population center. So they come, their first responders kind of come from different areas, and their calls are spread out, as are the homes in that county. So that's the EMS calls, and not much different when we turn to our map for fire calls. In 2014, the county handled just under 2,000 fire calls in St. Croix County. Again, as you can see, they're kind of spread out. What's interesting on this map is the number of calls on the interstate itself. I thought that was kind of interesting. But otherwise, you can see they're kind of concentrated around the population centers out here in the Wilson area. I know there was some consternation out in the southeast corner of the county, Mr. Peavy's area, and we're looking to address that through some radio upgrades. And we have fire calls out there that we hope to resolve with the phase two upgrades. And as you go through the county, you can see Deer Park, Forest Island. there are calls. There's no area that is spared either EMS or fire calls. New Richmond has a number of them on the south end, and in a moment I'll explain why that's relevant to us. And Somerset up north and into the Rice Lake Flats, and of course Star Prairie. So I just wanted to give you an idea of where our calls are, and I don't think any of this comes as a surprise that they're near our population centers. Again, this is our map of our current dispatch radio coverage. And as you can see on here, this is a topographical map. These areas here pose problems. There are areas up here, Rice Lake Flats, down into Star Prairie. We have no radio antennas or towers up in this area, so coverage sometimes is iffy, particularly if a sheriff's patrol officer is on a portable radio all the way down through here to Spring Valley. There's a challenge that this poses. Our county has nearly a 500 feet difference in elevation between Hudson and Glenwood City. And even within those municipalities, as you can see in Hudson, 185 feet difference from below the hill down there by Lakefront Park all the way to the top of the hill. And as you go through these, you can see the various differences in your respective jurisdictions or jurisdictions near where you live. Spring Valley is obviously one of the more difficult areas that we have radio problems with. 200 feet is the difference in Spring Valley between its low point and high point. And as you look on this map here, you can see with the topographical challenges, we have some engineering to do. The map in front of you is the phase two proposed dispatch coverage. Each of those are towers, as I indicated before. What's going to be added, that, by the way, that red one over there is the King plant. I keep wanting to call it the NSP plant. The Xcel Energy plant, we're adding, we have a site there now that's going to be converted to a microwave site and a backup emergency site. We hope to add a tower right there. That's called Hanley Road Water Tower. We're having a discussion with the city of Hudson. I'll leave it at that right now. We're adding onto the Roberts Water Tower. This is the Hammond. We're going to make some changes there. That'll get what's called an iFern base and some of our backup incident channels. Down in Baldwin, that tower is not ours in Baldwin. That tower is owned by Dairyland Power Co-op. They allow us graciously to be on that tower at no charge. In Woodville, talking about the east end of the county, in the Woodville area, we're hoping that Woodville on the water tower there will give us coverage in this valley and down towards Spring Valley. Up here, we're adding a tower at the Deer Park Highway Shop. New Richmond, we've been on the water tower at the Health Center. As most of you know, that water tower is empty. There was a substantial charge to upgrade an empty water tower that we made a decision on the county level. It didn't appear to be efficient. We'll talk about that in a moment. On the south end, if you'll recall from those fire and EMS calls, we ran some portable tests in that New Richmond High School. As I mentioned, the very nice high school I was in for the first time for the law enforcement memorial a couple weeks ago. But last year, they ran portable tests. The law enforcement officers took a portable, went into that high school and tried to talk out of that high school to dispatch. They could not reach dispatch. There are at least two schools in that area, if I'm not mistaken. How many?
Several.
Where that new high school is, I think there's one across the road, I believe. And if you have an active shooter, and you know, I've harped on this with the city council or with the Water Commission utility in Hudson about the need for tower and tower space, we decided to add on to the, back to my trusty pointer, to the South Water Tower in New Richmond. And I'd like to say on the record that the Village of Woodville, the Village of Roberts, and the City of New Richmond have all provided us space on their water towers at absolutely no cost to the county. When they determined that it was for public safety purposes, they opened their arms and said, come on in. We're paying for modifications. Obviously, we don't expect them to pay for our our mounts and our brackets and some welding and some painting that goes with those welds. They're very touchy with water towers, and for good reason. So we're going to be adding up on this tower here to cover the south area of New Richmond, which is also their growth area. And that kind of holds true for Hanley Road. Hanley is intended to cover the south part of Hudson, south and southeast, and I was informed, and I don't know how accurate it is, that the city of Hudson is looking to annex property, the old Livermore property, all the way down to the Y camp. Properties generally annexed only for one reason, development. That means it will increase density, makes it harder for a radial signal to penetrate. So Hanley is a very important site. And in Somerset, at the again, at the Highway Department shop, we'll be adding a tower there. Hopefully that will cover the Rice Lake Flats. In Star Prairie, we're hoping that the combination of Somerset, New Richmond, the old health center or nursing home, and Deer Park will get into Star Prairie. We're going to be simulcast broadcasting. What does that mean? Right now, our dispatchers have to push buttons and bring up different towers throughout the county. With this new system, they'll push one button, page everybody at the same time off all 11 sites that will be working. Same thing when we talk to our law enforcement officers, one button. They'll hear us everywhere in the county at one time. They won't have to switch channels in their car or make any changes themselves. This is kind of, I was trying to think of the best way to get an understanding of how radio signals work. This map in front of you, the green in this one, the color changes from maps. Right now, this is our current configuration. When we go to page, or for that matter, when we try to talk to a portable, and for them to hear us, as you can see, and I'm just going to start up in Deer Park, there's no green around Deer Park. When we page Deer Park firefighters and first responders, we usually get them, but it can be hit and miss up there. Glenwood City has a tower there, so coverage isn't too bad. But then you come down here to Baldwin and Woodville and further east, it can be very difficult to get a page, and a pager signal is the worst signal. The pager device that you see our volunteer fire and EMS people carry around is what we call the least sensitive piece of equipment there is, which makes it the most difficult to get a signal to. So if you're a firefighter in Woodville and you're in your basement watching the Packers, you may or may not get that signal under our current system. Again, why we're going to be adding tower locations in Baldwin and Woodville. Likewise, when you come over here in the Somerset area, that whole area there where you go down Anderson Scout Camp Road, Rice Lake Flats, very weak. The Somerset Tower should take care of that. Down in Troy, there are some issues, particularly along the river, when you try to page. Now, fortunately for us, most of our volunteer firemen and most of our volunteer EMTs and first responders, well, our first responders have a tendency to live out. That's why they're first responders. But our medics and our firefighters mostly live in the population centers, so their chances of a pager going off are much better. This is our proposed map for paging, red being the color of the day on this particular map. You can see Deer Park here, how we pick Deer Park up. Down here, we'll cover Baldwin, Woodville, Hammond, all the way over. The county line is right there. That's Wilson right about there. I don't imagine, Mr. Peavy, that we have a lot of volunteers that live in Wilson. One? Okay, hopefully they'll get the signal coming off that Woodville tower. River Falls, we're going to be talking about that tower in a minute. They cover that. These are the two towers that are proposed in Hudson. Roberts there. Two towers in Richmond that blends right into the Somerset area. So we're hoping with the simulcast broadcast of these towers to cover all the pagers and portable radios in the county. We're back to green again. This is currently the law enforcement radio system. We broadcast for our law enforcement off one of two locations, either at the King Stack or the Glenwood City. And what? Both, yes. And those broadcasts go out, but as you can see, there's this huge void in the middle of the county, virtually nothing south. And if you see gray means that you get a coin out and flip it whether or not they'll hear the signal. That is the current law enforcement radio map where officers hear us. Under our proposed system, this is where everyone will hear us in the green. And as you can see, that's the county line there, and county line there. We are always going to have problems down there in the Spring Valley area. The goal when we built this system was 100% mobile coverage, 90% portable coverage. To get 100% portable coverage, you would spend at least another $1 million probably, because you'd have to build another tower specifically down in that area. And frankly, we want to make sure every firefighter is protected, every law enforcement officer, and every emergency medical service person that goes out. It doesn't matter if there's one fire call there or 100 fire calls, they're entitled to our protection. And so we hope to use a variety of techniques. One of those I was talking about, the sheriff repeaters. Each of the sheriff's patrol cars will have what's called a mobile repeater. When they pick up their portable radio and talk on their portable radio, instead of trying to hit a distant tower, all they have to do is hit their patrol car with that signal, and the patrol car will rebroadcast it. That's why it's called a mobile repeater. With the fire department, as they go to more and more of an incident command system, a lot of the fire departments, if they're on portables for fire ground operations while fighting a fire, will radio their incident commander, who will then have a mobile radio to contact us. So we're very optimistic that we're going to have nearly uniform county coverage. This last map is a proposed mobile radio map where we will hear every mobile. And as you can see, if I can toggle between the maps, this is where everyone will hear us, which is good. But if they happen to get in trouble and squeeze that microphone, you can see how expanded the green area is, and we're hoping that we don't miss any calls. Okay, sooner or later you have to talk about the money. In the spring summer of 2004, the county retained PSC, which are consultants, to come in and give us a ballpark figure of what we would need. This was not a study. We just made our general needs known to them. But they didn't study the system. We talked about next-gen 911, our radio consoles, our emergency medical dispatch, about the towers, the shelters, the radios, the microwave, and related equipment. With that information in front of them, they gave us a ballpark figure of $6.3 million. Now comes the bond issue, and I wasn't here. I don't know exactly what the understanding was, but my understanding is the county bonded $10 million for various capital projects. They did those capital projects, whatever they were. I think there was some paving and some other things that were done with that $10 million. When they got done with that $10 million, there was $5.426 million left. This was not a budget amount. This was simply a set-aside amount that was to be applied towards whatever dollar amount was ever achieved or set in deciding the Phase 2 upgrade. So keeping that in mind, we continue on. In December of 2014, our PSC consultants gave us kind of what I would call our first bona fide estimate. Not a lot different than their ballpark figure at 6.388. It was the first estimate of a future cost number. There was no contingencies or fees built in. And again, this was not a budget amount, and it was before a look under the hood. This was before any engineering was done. So how are costs revised, and how do we end up where we're going to end up as we are tonight? Well, we started with this ballpark cost estimate, then we proceeded to the engineering study. And during that engineering study, it's a time for the engineers to come in and the consultants and discuss with us, learn our detailed needs and what our available existing resources are. It's a time for them to analyze those population centers and maps that we looked at earlier. No surprises there about where calls are generally going to be in the population centers. And then they get into the technical details. And this is really, when I talk about that look under the hood, this is where you get that look under the hood. They open it up and start going through. They start looking for tower sites and available space. Establish microwave sites. Microwave are a line of sight. If trees or any other obstacles get in the way, you either have to go higher up on a tower or find a different tower. They have to review tower suitability and structural integrity. That's in yellow for a reason, because it's going to come up as the reason that most of these costs were revised. They have to generate the and study the radial propagation maps. Those are those red and green color maps they put in using a computer program. They put in, basically, it's a hypothetical. If we had a tower here transmitting on normal power, what would it do, how would it do, and what area would it cover? They determine suitable construction conditions to ensure we have to get soil sampling for new towers, things of that nature, land, loading factors for towers and things of that nature. And then, of course, you have to vet the solutions. So what you have is your ballpark figures, your rough estimate, and then the engineering study comes in. You take a look under the hood, and you find out, is this going to work, or are there problems? We ran into, I'll call it three revisions. Our first major revision was the Somerset Telephone Company tower. We had set aside $413,000, which was included in that 6.388. But the telephone company tower in Somerset was later deemed not a suitable investment. First of all, you were going to invest, as tax, representing taxpayers, $413,000 into a tower you would not own, putting equipment in there that you would probably never recover if we got kicked out of there, plus the doozy, as I call it, and you were going to pay them rent to be on it. It was just determined that from a cost efficiency perspective, it would not work. Instead, it was determined that a new tower would be constructed at the Somerset Highway Department location up on the hill in Somerset by the fire station. The cost of that tower, with all the soil tests and everything that goes into a tower, was $766,000. We backed out the $413,000 that had been budgeted, so everybody can do the math. That added $353,000 to our cost estimate. Our second major revision was New Richmond. As I said earlier, we've been using the New Richmond Health Center, the empty water tower up there. Well, we're looking to put approximately six foot dishes, microwave dishes, more than likely at least two of them on the New Richmond Health Center location. And on an empty water tower, when you start loading it up with microwave dishes and antennas, plus I think the estimate Terry was near $100,000 to renovate that tower to get it in working order. Now you have a $100,000 improved water tower that's still empty and not being used. There was concerns about a healthy storm coming by, knocking down an empty water tower. If you ever look in the news and you see these pictures of areas devastated by tornadoes and stuff, take a look next time and see how many water towers are standing. They're always standing. Don't ask me why, but they're all, bet you dollars to donuts, they're always filled with water. If they were empty, they'd probably come down. So it was determined it was not suitable and not long-term cost-effective. So we looked at what can we do to replace it. The decision was made to add what's called a monopole, which, as you can see, at $580,000 is cheaper than a real tower, but a monopole, because of height limitations there, because of the airport, we cannot build a structure any higher than the current water tower. That's an FAA rule, because we're within 1,000 feet of the runway or something of that nature. And so the bottom line there is we're going to put in a monopole. And I will say this about all the towers we're building. I wouldn't say overloading them. There used to be a tower ordinance in St. Croix County. And one of the things you folks required in your ordinance, which is currently kind of hanging out there because the state preempted all the municipalities from promulgating tower ordinances that weren't in compliance with the new state statute, one of the things that the county ordinance said was that you should build it for co-location. What are the advantages of co-location? You don't have to build as many towers. What are the advantages of co-location for St. Croix County? rent. So our towers are going to be built for co-location to comply with the, we're trying to comply with the old tower ordinance as much as we can. I think as county folks, we should be as much in compliance with that ordinance as we can, even though it doesn't exist. One of the advantages is cell phone companies need space. Even though the state has preempted tower construction in the state and said you can't charge any more than fair market value, in a lot of areas, I'll take fair market value. So the potential is for rent, but I'm not going to try to fool you that the rent's going to cover the cost of construction. It will just be a nice add-on if it comes. So that Richmond North replacement monopole is $580 added to the previous cost estimate, and now we're at 7.322. In April, Terry and Steve Bonham and myself sat down and scrubbed 1,800 cost boxes that the engineers consultants gave us. We went through every box to see where we could cut, what make sure there were no errors, make sure that it was computed accurately, made any modifications that were necessary. We ended up subtracting $78,000 out of that number. And then we ran into another, and as you can see there, with the contingencies and consultant fees, we came to 7.9 million. There was a question about what's the useful life of this span of equipment. It varies from 10 to 40 years. You have radio towers that will go 20, 30, 40 years. You have antennas that will go 10, 20, 30, 40 years. But a lot of the stuff that's driven by software today, we're going to be paying annual charges. We're going to have to upgrade along the way. So some of the equipment will have a useful life of perhaps 10 years, but it will need software and firmware upgrades as we go along. And here's the buzzsaw we ran into on May 14th. We currently, as you saw on one of our maps there, we share a tower in Pierce County. That River Falls Tower, as we call it, is not owned by St. Croix County. It's owned by Pierce County, and they have allowed us on that tower for free for years, very graciously. St. Croix County uses it for Troy, Kinnikinick, Pleasant Valley, and Rush River Township. We use it to page the River Falls Fire and EMS, and we use it to page the Spring Valley Fire and EMS as well. On May 14th, we are notified. We have to do due diligence on all of our towers to ensure structural integrity. Obviously not the new ones because we're putting them up. But any existing tower, we did it in Glenwood City, and we looked at the Hammond one as well. Glenwood City is good. Hammond's good. But River Falls, it failed the initial structural integrity analysis. So last Friday, Terry put together an emergency meeting, and we went down to Ellsworth and met with Pierce County and Dairyland Power Co-op. You may ask why Dairyland Power Co-op? Because Dairyland Power Co-op is essential to Pierce County's operations. Pierce County's radio towers are all connected by Dairyland Power Co-op microwave system. They own a microwave site and a tower at Baldwin that we use next to the Ag Center. So we sat down and discussed our options there. We haven't come to a conclusion yet. There's different things in the wind right now. But as my father used to say, hope for the best and plan for the worst. So what I'm presenting to you tonight is the worst case scenario, is the cost of building a new tower at approximately $450,000 plus land purchase. That if we're going to build a new tower, it would likely then be in St. Croix County. And for some reason, when you cross the county line into St. Croix County, land gets a little more expensive. So we're going to look at land, but we're also looking at our other options. Dairyland has been very good to us. Pierce County, the sheriff, we met with her. She indicated they just bonded an $18 million new public safety center, and frankly, they don't have much to cost share with. We were hoping to go down there and get a third, and a third, but it doesn't look that way now. So we're going to look at cost-efficient and beneficial alternatives to building in the River Falls area. It may be a new tower, if worse comes to worse, or there may be other solutions. We will look at it as hard as we can. So that brings us to the $7.6 million plus contingencies and consultant fees, which will tip it over the $8 million mark. Those contingencies, by the way, are about, as you saw in one of the previous slides, they're over $300,000. It would be nice not to dip into those. We're buying shelters for some of the locations. Terry went scrounging. I hope, it wasn't eBay, was it? We actually found some very good condition used shelters that we've already purchased at substantial discounts. The cellular phone companies abandon shelters left and right. They left the Hudson, Wisconsin Water Tower Street location. They left the shelter behind. The city of Hudson was very gracious to us and said, if you want to use it, it's yours. So we're really hunting, and they're generally in very good condition. So we're hunting down used shelters to see how much money we can save. Other equipment, you don't really want to be on eBay buying used. There was an issue, the public protection to its committee, to its credit, the chairman and the vice chairman and the members asked us to look at digital radio systems. And I understand that as part of our due diligence, we did. The principal difference between digital and analog, almost everyone who has a cell phone today, they used to be analog, they're digital. Clear, crisp signals. There are some problems, though, because either you have a signal or you don't have a signal, which in the public safety world can pose problems. There are what's called conventional and trunking digital radio systems. For those of you familiar, Minnesota did a multi-million dollar trunking system. It's called the Armor system. It's an 800 megahertz trunking radio system. It is extremely expensive. We believe that we can get by in a digital system with 8 tower sites instead of 11. The problem is that would work for the digital system, but because there are no viable digital pagers, we have to continue to use analog pagers. And because the vast majority of our first responders in St. Croix County are not law enforcement officers who work full time, they're volunteers, firefighters and EMS. And since we don't have a way to alert them if we don't alert them by pager, and because there is no viable digital pager, we need the multiple radio sites, all 11 of them, to alert the pagers. I thought I would throw out the minimal additional expense to the county if we went digital. For us, about $386,000. If we went trunking, about $1.2 million for a basic system. One of the goals and objectives when we started this thing, at least what I've been told, is you wanted to minimize any impact on the public safety responders' cost to them. Well, with digital systems, a conventional digital system would probably tack on over $750,000 to the public safety volunteers out there and law enforcement agencies out in the field. Trunking would be at $1.2 million. That would be quite a cost impact to them. However, we didn't stop there and say no. We learned today, about 2 hours ago, that Motorola has come out with a new product that our engineers learned about yesterday. That's how fast this technology changes. We think, and again, when we send out for a request for proposals, that we can build an entire digital backbone system, and down the road, we can convert on a transitional basis as departments buy new radios to digital. So we can obtain our objective, if it is an objective, and I think ultimately it should be, of a totally digital system. Digital system, what does it do for us? Again, clear, crisp conversations. You can move digital data across a digital system. Our CAD systems, there's so many other things that there's a potential to use a digital system for. And of course, in 10 years from now, we wouldn't even be having this discussion, because in 10 years from now, you wouldn't be able to find an analog radio. So I think what we're going to look at is, if it's cost reasonable, on a cost-benefit analysis, is to build the entire backbone on a digital-capable system, and then as departments buy new radios, they can transition and dispatch can hear either one of them. There, by the way, is no FCC requirement as of this date to go digital. Some of you will remember we were forced to go narrow-banding, but when we were forced to go narrow-banding, the FCC gave us 14 years to do that. So even if the FCC were to set down rules telling us to go digital, I'm sure they would give us a decade to do that. So there's a real chance we could end up in a digital system. One other thing I want to say about that dollar figure. I think we need to be careful calling it a budget figure. I think all the pieces of the puzzle are now in, but you also have to remember, we have not gone to RFPs yet, requests for proposals. So the next step, when you're looking at that dollar figure, is we hope our consultants are right on the money, and that as the requests for proposals and the bids come in, they're exactly within what our consultants believe they will be. And so I will leave you with this last slide. I said there were two important slides. The first one was telling you that St. Croix County has done no substantial upgrade in 36 years. So what does that mean? Well, when phase two is done, St. Croix County will have better information received and dispatched through the next gen 911 and our emergency medical dispatch protocol system. We'll have one button paging and radio communications through new consoles and simulcast broadcasting. Dispatchers won't have to go around and pick towers to try to alert firefighters and volunteers and police officers. We'll have broader pager, portable, and mobile coverage through seven new sites and the use of those mobile repeaters we discuss. We'll have improved ability to dispatch and hear calls around the county through our microwave links and our rebroadcasts. And we'll have enhanced response for major critical incidents through our mass notification and our communications van upgrade. With that, I leave it, Mr. Chairman, to you for questions by the members.
At this time, are there any questions? Anybody? Supervisor Schobert.
Yeah, a question, the engineering study, when exactly did that first come back before you started to make some changes to it? I know the first change was made in February of 2015. When did you actually get the engineering study back?
I came about that time, so.
If you're asking about the actual engineering study, it's always been a work in progress. It was back in October we started doing the structural analysis of each of the tower sites, but it takes time to have the tower crews go up, draw where all the antennas are, all the coax, take all the pictures of all the connections, all the guide wires, all that. It took time to go through. December was the first time where they actually gave us the spreadsheet of where they thought everything should be. But once, as Steve indicated, when we lifted the hood, that's when everything started getting really down in the weeds and investigating each tower site individually. And that's kind of how we ended up where we are now. So hopefully that answered your question.
Another question, the shelters you're talking about all the time, are those equipment shelters only, just for equipment? Right?
That's correct. They're the shelters at the base of the towers that house all the radio infrastructure and the microwave radios that transport the data all around our system.
They're generally prefab. They drop them generally with a crane onto a cement slab.
Third question, why pagers and not cell phones, since everybody's carrying around a cell phone anyway? And you say pagers have a real tough time with receptivity. I mean, it's probably an ignorant question, but answer that one.
I'm sorry. The cell phones, you were at the will of the cell phone provider, so to speak. If their system goes down, or if it's a text message or anything of that nature, data, you're at the will of that provider. They can hang it up there and then push it to you later. If it's something that we have control of, we can deliver that message instantaneously. The departments have control over that piece of equipment. They're not relying on the volunteer to provide their own cell phone, so to speak, for that. It's an actual piece of equipment that they have control of, and we can kind of, I don't want to say dictate, but we control what equipment they're using and know that they got good or fairly good equipment.
I think as a follow-up to that, probably not a lot of people realize it, and I discovered it on 9/11 in Washington, is that the government, there are two sets of phones now, post-911. If a major incident happens, your phone, everyone in this room may get their phone shut down. High-ranking government officials in the Twin Cities, in Washington, wherever it may be, will operate as priority. And they will get the priority to the cell system, the cell towers. So if we had a major emergency and they shut us out, you'd be shutting out every one of our volunteer firefighters and medics from receiving a signal.
And then my last question, while you two sound very competent and knowledgeable, who do you confer with to just get a second opinion on this big problem we're all facing? And is it common for other counties to be encountering the same thing? And do you have colleagues in other counties that you're collaborating with?
Both.
Yeah, the consultants is who we're relying on. One of the things when Steve came on board is he wanted to make sure when we're close to the end of this that we have the system evaluated, that it's proper and efficient for what we're asking it to do. One of the things that we're going to do at the end is have a test done, I don't want to say GPS, but something of that nature. Every spot in the county, they'll do a test to make sure that we identify every possible spot in the county, whether it's a good signal or if there is a poor, and identify them so we know if we have a generalized area that's poor or weak in coverage, that we have to do something to enhance that or try to find a strategy to take care of that. We're always using people around us, our consultants. They've done multiple different counties in Wisconsin and in Minnesota, so we're always looking, asking questions. They're sharing with us ideas and telling us, you know, this county's doing this. By all means, reach out to them, talk to them, and we've been doing that. So,
this may be an uninformed question, but when you referenced Motorola and some changes in terms of the digital, I'm curious about does broadband not used at all versus a tower?
Broadband for our purposes, as you've heard in the internet world, doesn't really affect us. We won't be using the broadband that the FCC has been talking about for expanding in rural areas. That will be mainly used to provide internet coverage for people who live in more remote areas.
What more specifically did Motorola suggest can happen that you just learned about today? I guess I was trying to put that piece into place. You had got some information today, you noted, from Motorola regarding the digital.
As Mr. Takash noted, that today we learned from our meeting with the consultants that there's a hybrid system that one of the brands out there, Motorola, is trying to provide. It's brand new. They just learned about it. There's more information next week that they're going to learn about. And it's kind of to facilitate or foster agencies or counties like us that are kind of in between analog, legacy, and going digital. It's their way of trying to get into that market. Now, there's other vendors out there, EF Johnson, Tate, all of them will have a foot in the ring, if you will, on trying to get our business. It was just one of them that they brought up, but each of them are trying to get our business, so it's actually working in our favor of being a competitive pricing for the project we're coming up to. So that's keeping our eyes and our ideas open to change and different ideas to hopefully drive the price down of the whole project. So that's kind of why we always keep hearing new solutions.
And I think one of the things you have to be careful in the high-tech world, I haven't seen it so much as I've seen it in the high-tech world, are proprietary systems. And sometimes, whether it's Motorola or someone else, you can get stuck in a proprietary system, which means every piece of add-on equipment you need, you have to buy from that company, kind of like Apple. Same thing. So we're going to try to be careful when we go in our request for proposals. And in fact, we talked about it this afternoon about possibly actually putting out different requests for proposals so we can compare apples with apples and apples with oranges.
Supervisor Okroff?
Yeah, I just want to make sure I understand. From the $10 million in 2014, you have approximately $5.5 million left.
Well, when you say we have it,
Well, no, there's that's left to apply to you.
That's my understanding.
Okay, okay. And the total cost of this is approximately $8 million.
Approximately today, provided we use every penny of it, we'd be right around just over $8
million. Okay, so we only really need $2.5 to $3 million, hopefully, max, above and beyond what we already have available to us to use.
I believe that's an accurate statement.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure I understood that.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Supervisor Peavy.
Thank you. Just for Roy's information, I carry a pager and a cell phone. And I'll get my page, and I'll have a dead cell phone. So down in my corner, and again, we talked about that. So pager works, cell phone doesn't. Cell phone does, pager doesn't. So, but the pager, I get my pages from United continuously. So just follow up on that one.
Well, and if I may follow up on that, Mr. Chairman, cell phone companies are in the business of profit, and they won't put up a cell site unless the area will support it from a profit standpoint. And I know that a few of you have told me when you're driving up 63 or there are places in this county, you don't get a cell phone signal. I don't get a cell phone signal in my office down here. I have to go out in the hallway and Janet's going, what are you doing standing like that? But there are places in St. Croix County where you just won't get a cell phone signal. Why? Because it's not profitable for the cell phone company.
Any other questions? Supervisor Nelson.
That's the third time I saw that presentation. It gets better every time.
Yeah.
The numbers don't change, but the numbers don't lie either. But I've been in this business a long time. I'm sure you've all heard my little stories. But this is huge for this county. Huge. The problem is we're getting no help from the state. We're on our own here, folks, until they figure out regionalization of doing programs and the half-cent sales tax for a county to pay for the, you know, we got the car tire tax to take care of the transportation. I joke, but I'm kind of half serious when you say we might have to do a 0.5% to take care of our emergency services in the county because the state's not helping us either. I'm lucky I work under 800 megahertz. We're still years behind with this system. The state's playing catch-up, but they're not helping you. That's why this is on us. And our emergency services people deserve that. I don't worry. I'm not actually scared about the numbers because it could have been a lot more. If we'd done 800 megahertz, we're talking upwards of $20, $30 million just for this county. Until the state gets on board and starts taking a leadership role in emergency services, we're flipping the bill.
Supervisor Nielsen.
At a previous public protection meeting, I asked about the old Nike base site out at Roberts, which I am told is the highest point of land in the county or close to it. I've been there, and you can stand on the ground. You can see the city of Hammond clearly. You can see the city of New Richmond. You can see the Allen S. King chimney. And it wouldn't surprise me if you could see River Falls. And I'm just wondering why we didn't attempt to contact the property owners there.
When we were looking at property for the various tower sites, you always have to look as to where the populations are around the county as well. Granted, yes, it is one of the tallest elevations in the county. At the top of the Roberts Water Tower, you can see Hammond, you can see the New Richmond Water Towers, you can see the King Stack. All of them can connect with one another, but you also have to remember that was part of the study of looking over all 40 various sites of making sure we have the connectivity with the microwave system, but also to be in the actual population centers with the towers. If we would have slid to the north of Roberts up into the Nike base, we might have lost the school possibly with having the penetration into a hardened building, or if there was an incident down at the cement factory down near I-94. It was kind of one of them, we always had a juggling act, the consultants call, trying to weigh pros and cons and trying to find that fine line of what's best and what's most economical. The Roberts Water Tower, we didn't have to purchase land. We didn't have to deal with anybody around us. The Village of Roberts was excellent to us. He said, yes, by all means, come on. As they're not charging us rent. We're just paying for modifications on the tower, and it's looking to be a very good, viable tower for us.
I think one of the objectives, Mr. Chairman, it was to try to avoid any large capital outlay that wasn't necessary, and by utilizing all these free water towers, because we'll take a free ride anywhere we can get it, we were able to minimize the number of towers we needed. And as you can see from our maps, we're only putting towers in areas that either have been underserved or not served at all in the past, and then looking at the replacement, what we're going to do in River Falls with the potentially defective tower. I think the jury's still out on that.
Are there any other questions? Supervisor Osnes?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First of all, Mr. Nelson, thank you very much for your comments. You hit it right on the head, sir, and I appreciate that. Second, thanks to Terry and Steve and your entire staff for working on this for as long as you've had and all the hours that you put in. Steve, thank you again for our visit that we had again yesterday afternoon. You answered a lot of questions. It was a very candid conversation, and I do appreciate that. My one question that I have left would be, as we go to code red on July 1st, you mentioned that folks would have to sign up for that. And my question is, the folks that are under City Watch right now, will they have to re-sign up, or will that be carried over?
With code red, it's a total, I guess, wipe of the system. Everybody with a landline phone is gonna be put into the database regardless. The 911 data dump that we get from AT&T is gonna be dumped into the system. Everybody that has a wireless device can create an account on the code red that's gonna have a link on the county website. A citizen can create an account, maintain that account, edit the account. If they move, get an additional cell number, they can have emails on there. You can select whether you want text messaging, email, voice. There's a whole ancillary of options you can choose. And you can opt out of certain things as well, I'm told. That's one of the things Mr. Takash hinted at. There's a lot of additional tools in there that we're learning more about. Training's coming up next week, as a matter of fact, for several of us. So that's one of the things. The people that signed up for City Watch, yes, they'll have to re-register, but I believe it's going to be a total just wipe. Everybody starts off new, and I've been sharing that with all the citizens that have called regarding the Nourishment incident last month. So.
Thank you, and I would encourage anybody that's got a cell phone to sign up for that. You know, we're getting less and less folks that are on landline. One of the things that we talked about, I know when we first went on City Watch, how important it was if mom and dad are in the cities and you got a snowstorm over here, make sure your kids have got a cell phone, make sure mom and dad have got a cell phone so they can hear if we've got bad weather or issues going on. I think it's very important for the whole family to sign up for that.
I think, Mr. Osnes, that one of the things we'll do when we're comfortable with it in July is we'll issue press releases to the media about how it operates and how to find the website to sign up.
Good, thank you.
In additional as well for the code red, currently City Watch, when we send a message out, the caller ID shows unknown or private. For most folks with the code red, we can actually input a number in tell it what number to display, so citizens will understand after a while that it's actually coming from a 386 phone number or whatever we decide to put in there. But we can control that, hopefully foster that it's something important.
Super. Thank you both.
Supervisor Geister.
Just a comment. I would just ask that, because I am on City Watch and I was in Richmond and I didn't get my call until about 5:30 in the morning. Way after the incident was already resolved. Having said that, I would just ask that you would put out, before you dismantle City Watch, a message like you did there to have folks sign up for Code Red. That way the individuals that are on that miss the press releases, miss this simulcast, miss different things, would know that they should be signing up for Code Red.
Yeah, that was one of the downfalls of City Watch. If you signed up for City Watch and moved away, there was no way for you to notify us of that. That is part of the program of Code Red of doing a master PR campaign to let everybody know that. So yes, we'll attempt to do that.
Any other questions? Supervisor Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm concerned about, we talk about buying parts on eBay and obsolescence. This is real money. What are we going to be able to do to ensure against the onset of obsolescence so that we don't put another term of the county board somewhere down the road in this sticker shock situation where they have to go back and explain to their constituents why we're now having to come up with these millions of dollars? Are we going to be able to maintain this system so that it stays current and doesn't slam a population, say 10 or 15 years down the road, the way we're being slammed at this moment?
I think part of that is maintenance. Because there's so much software and firmware and IP-driven parts to this, you have to have maintenance and upkeep with it. The other thing is, with all due respect, county boards are somewhat adverse to setting aside money for a capital project. I was here working for the county as a 911 director, as I told you, from 81 to 90, and to try to get them to set aside money that you knew you were going to need, whether it was the old $48,000 dictaphone recorder in the 911 center, we knew it was going to heck. It was another one of those bubblegum and, you know, paper clip operations, and we asked them, can you put $25,000 a year aside for 2 years or so? And for some reason, I don't know if there's a fear somebody's going to raid the account, or there seems to be an aversion to building, and I frankly don't know the law on setting aside funds for future capital expenditures, but I don't think there's any question somebody, obviously long after Terry and I, will be back at this podium here, maybe in a different building, I don't know, you know, looking to upgrade this radio system at some point down the road. If you lose a tower, most of those are insured, but they're just built-in obsolescence, and when your lifespan of your equipment, as you asked us a few weeks ago, when you're looking at 10 years on one side and 40 on the other, there will be another county board down the road. Unfortunately, it's probably going to get sticker shock again, unless there's some change in the funding mechanism to build in for those things. It's like the comm van. You know, a replacement communications van is about $250,000, maybe a little bit more. We're at the end of the life span. We've talked with Mr. Thompson about it. As you can see, we're looking at upgrading it, but those are the type of things that maybe 4 or 5 years ago the county should have put, you know, somewhere back there a capital amount aside. I don't know. I'm not the finance guy, but that would be my thought on it.
Any other? Supervisor Nielsen.
When the county board is in the future asked to take action on phase two, is it going to come directly to the board, or is it going to go through public protection first, or administration, or both?
Probably go through both.
Any other questions? Thank you, Steve and Terry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good night. Thank you, members.
Thank you. We'll move on. I'll go to Mr. Thompson, our administrator, for appointments.
Yes, we just have one appointment this evening, and that is to fill the vacant seat on the St. Croix County Economic Development Corporation. We had two board members represent interest in serving on the EDC. I've met with both members, Supervisor Nelson, Supervisor Hansen, before the meeting, and we reached an agreement that Supervisor Hansen would receive the appointment at this point to fill the unexpired term on the seat vacated by Supervisor Osnes, and then once that term is up, we would revisit the appointment and reconfirm it, or possibly at that point reconsider. So it gives me great pleasure to recommend the appointment of Supervisor Hansen to fill the open seat on the Economic Development Corporation.
Do I have a motion to approve? Supervisor Osnes?
I would move to accept the appointment of Dan Hansen to the EDC board.
Do I have a second? Second. Supervisor Ring? We have a motion and a second. Everybody ready to vote?
Yeah.
All yeses. Thank you. We'll move on to our reports. We have one from the HHS Director Fred Johnson tonight.
Excuse me. Could we? Mr. Chair.
What? Excuse me.
Since we have, I was wondering, could we have people waiting in the audience who've been here for the
could we move
item
that
on the agenda? Would you mind moving that up? And Fred, would you be okay with that?
The one on the...
Pardon me? So the business resolution support for continued defederalization. We've got people from Eau Claire.
Yeah, we can do that. If that's okay with the rest of the board members, we can move that up. We'll move to the resolution supporting the continued defederalization of regional consolidated resolve loan funds. So you have a motion to that? Supervisor Trotner's motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Second.
Supervisor Berkey. Discussion? Supervisor Ring.
Yes, so what the resolution to support for continued defederalization of the regional consolidated revolving loan fund, we heard some background about that. We had a presentation at our community development committee, and we talked about it. And we have Bill Rubin here, I'm sure would provide some background. If your packet had a lot of background information, Beth provided some more. Before I speak to that, I would like to just say thank you to both Lynn and Beth for coming here tonight and making that presentation. Lynn Nelson has been the director at the Regional Planning Commission for about a year. And under her leadership, there is a lot of good work happening. And this packet that you got tonight, I hope you really take a look at it. And I hope for each of your communities that you think about when you have questions about can we do something, please look at this. Because there's just a lot of good work and there's a lot of talented people that can help that. With the Regional Business Fund, one thing I wanted to point out, and just in the report, they talk about the loans that were distributed in that program this year. And so if you look at, it's the first thing under the St. Croix County thing. Through the Regional Business Fund and the Consolidated Regional Community Development Block Grant Revolving Loan Fund Program that the Regional Planning Commission runs, 8 loans were provided to St. Croix County for a total of $198,800, creating and retaining a total of 17 jobs and leveraging $372,600 in private investment. That was just this year. If you look, St. Croix County has benefited immensely from this program. There have been a total of 98 loans. The loans have been given in Baldwin, in Emerald, Glenwood City, Hammond, Hudson, New Richmond, River Falls, Roberts, Somerset, Wilson, and Woodville. That's been the total amount, total overall is, it's about $7.9 million. The loans have gone from site acquisition to expansion to one thing that I'm excited about is startup. There's not many funds available for startup. So, and then that's also leveraged in the past, if you look at a total, about $42 million in private funds. So I know Bill Rubin is here, if there's anything more, that people want to know. So I just wanted to speak in favor of it. I think it's a very good program. And I would like to also ask, and I don't know that it has to be part of the, or maybe I will move to amend it to also send to a few other people, Senator Vinehout, Senator Bewley, Representative Petrick, and Representative Quinn. That would be on, so I would move to amend the ordinance to add those at line 41. Is there a second?
Supervisor Hansen, second that amendment. Does everybody understand what the amendment is? Is there any discussion? If there's no discussion, we will vote on the amendment. And we'll add that amendment under the resolution. And now we're back to the original motion on the resolution. Is there any discussion on the original resolution as amended? Mr. Babbitt?
I will admit to being a little nervous about this, and maybe it's because of a lack of knowledge. So are we saying that if we were to, in essence, continue to allow the federal government to manage this fund, that those things you just recited to us, Supervisor Ring, would not have happened? It sounds like partly the discussion we heard earlier is that if we leave this in the hands of the Housing and Urban Development, this program basically shuts down. I don't know if I heard that correctly. But I think I'd like to be a little more clear about what we lose, if you will, if we were to vote against this resolution, as opposed to what we gain if we do.
The state oversight agency for our, I'll back up. The original source of these funds came from Housing and Urban Development in the form of community development block grants. So the funds came from HUD to the state of Wisconsin, and then the state of Wisconsin awarded in our region 32 communities and counties these individual revolving loan funds. So the funds have always had a federal identity up until we defederalized them and went through this process of defederalization. We always had a relationship with our state agency in reporting because they are still federal funds. They just lost the program income portion of it, where we didn't have to follow the federal regulations anymore. So this resolution is in support of us being able to maintain our status as defederalized. We really don't have a choice as to whether we have to report to the Department of Administration, who then reports to HUD on these programs. We'll always remain under that umbrella. What the resolution is stating is that along with the other counties and communities in our region, that the St. Croix County feels that we did as we were instructed back in 2007, and you're supporting our plea to HUD to allow us to continue to remain as a defederalized fund. So what will happen is either HUD will come back and after getting all of the information we provided, all of the resolutions from the communities and the counties in our region, they will come back and with a number of responses, one of which could be, you didn't do it right. We're not going to be receiving any more information from you. You're stuck with federal funds. So that's one reality. Worst case scenario. Best case scenario, they review the information, and with all of the support, will allow us to continue on as defederalized.
If I could follow up, sure. Mr. Chairman, I guess in all honesty, I'm still not sure what the advantage was to St. Croix County, speaking just for ourselves at the moment, to defederalize. And again, that's maybe a steep learning curve for me.
Sure.
But you bring up an interesting point that if we don't yet have a decision from HUD about what they're going to do in regards to this, are we jumping the gun by voting on the resolution today, knowing that next week HUD could say, well, sorry, we're going to reverse course?
Two things I can speak to. The benefits of St. Croix County back in 2007 joining the Regional Business Fund and going through this defederalization process is that it opened the St. Croix County up to additional funds. So prior, St. Croix County had a pot of money, and I don't recall how much cash there was available, but I think it was about $136,000 within St. Croix County. When we took all of the 32 revolving loan funds and combined them into one, it created a pot of $5 million. So St. Croix County was no longer restricted to just the amount of money in that one account. It could use all of the accounts and all of the repayments. And then going through the process of defederalizing, it removed the federal requirements, which opened St. Croix County and the remainder of the counties up to the facade loan program, which allowed businesses to, in downtown and in the downtowns of the municipalities, to obtain up to $30,000 at 0% without having to abide by Davis-Bacon wage rates and without having matching funds. So that program specifically was a result of defederalizing the funds. The microloan program for business startups, that program was another program that was directly a result of defederalizing the funds. So we were able to help the downtown businesses, those small startups, start up with $25,000 and without any other funding available. So those two programs in particular. The other major, the other benefit for the businesses in St. Croix County is that if there was a company that was building a building and they had no other needs, they didn't have working capital needs or equipment needs, they were just strictly building a building, it really, because of Davis-Bacon, the reasonableness of obtaining this type of funding prior to defederalization, it just wasn't reasonable with the level of reporting and the additional costs. So as going through the defederalization process, then our fund, St. Croix County's funds, would be able to be used to help that business create the jobs. So we would be able to fund a construction project, or we would be able to help that business purchase the land. Where in the past, it was really only working capital and equipment purchases on a much smaller scale. So it really opened up St. Croix County with availability of cash and be able to reach a lot more businesses and create help businesses create a lot more jobs. It also streamlined administration, brought down the administrative costs. There was a great reduction in delinquencies and write-offs, so all of the funds were being kept with revolving instead of being used on additional administration and then end up being written off because of bad debt. I'm sorry, I don't remember the second question.
Okay. Supervisor
I promise not to keep monopolizing the microphone. That's helpful, and I think I'm a little clearer than I was when I started asking questions. And maybe just a final comment, and this is not at all a reflection on what's been happening with the regional group or here in St. Croix County, because I'm really impressed with everything that's been done by RPC and by our county EDC as well. But the state EDC is a disaster. And the extent to which the state EDC is involved in the background makes me very nervous. And maybe, again, that's not entirely fair in the sense mm-hmm. of my understanding about the link between what's happening at the state EDC mm-hmm. and more local EDCs, sure. But that makes me nervous.
Supervisor Ring.
On the second question that we did talk about at the Community Development Committee meeting, and I think we are saying that it is very separate. There are a lot of rules and regulations that go with this program, even in the defederalized state. And there is an underwriting practice. There is a lot of rigor that goes into the decisions, and there are a lot of rules that go with this. By being defederalized, though, we get this, we get more flexibility, which is what Beth explained. If we had to create, Davis-Bacon wage rates, if you're not aware, typically people think they're, 20 or 30% higher. So that's what would make, it would kick out a project that might be eligible under the defederalized rules and just make it impractical under the old rules. If we have to be defederalized, if we have to be federalized, I think we will just have to deal with that and figure it out. Programs ran for years with those rules. The profile of the participants would probably be very different, and I think there would be many fewer. And I know Beth has explained an example. If one of the things we want to do is job creation, that's the thing that we look at now. Well, under the federal rules, that just is that's a nightmare, and I don't know if we want to get into that.
And I did remember the second question as far as the timeliness of passing this resolution. We were told on April 1st that we were federalized, and the Department of Administration, essentially, we had a letter from the Department of Administration and HUD saying we were federalized. So we could have walked away at that point and just shrugged our shoulders and said, well, I guess we just have to live with this. But we didn't think that was appropriate. So we have been fighting this. And what has occurred now is that as a result of us fighting this ruling, HUD has agreed to review it. And that's why the support from the region is so important, so that it's not just us at the Regional Business Fund pushing this forward, it's the support of the whole region. So it's very, very timely.
Okay. Supervisor Schoberg.
I picked up on a comment that you had made earlier, and it seems, I want to know the reason why we weren't awarded the continuing defederalization. Did you mention something about not enough support going to low-income
families. And so now if we defederalize, we're supporting already can-do businesses, expand their businesses. And so tell me the reason why you were told the program is not succeeding in the eyes of HUD before I make my judgment myself.
They didn't say that the program wasn't succeeding because it was meeting. Defederalization is allowable under the Housing and Community Development Act of 1974 under this provision called 105A15. So there's a process through which regional revolving loan funds can defederalize, and we took advantage of that back in 2007. So it's allowable under HUD. HUD recognizes defederalized programs. So what they're telling us is that it's not that our program isn't successful, it's that the process that we were told back in 2007 to defederalize, HUD was wrong when they told us how to do it. So they've looked back and said, what you were told back then is wrong on the process. This is the process that you need to take. So you essentially need to start over. And we find that extremely unfair. Especially to all the communities and counties that have consolidated and all the good work that we've done. As you can see on the back page of the two-pager, all of the businesses that have been helped. So it's not that HUD is saying that we did something that we aren't successful. It's that the process we took was wrong. And what I have provided, which I will be providing to HUD tomorrow, is that it comes down to a very small very, very small technicalities. Back in 2012, HUD didn't audit of the state CDBG program, of which there were multiple findings and concerns on how the state was handling the CDBG program. One of the findings and concerns related to the 105A15s, which the regional business fund is. What they referred to in the HUD audit was an issue with what they're calling these three-party agreements. So it was an agreement between the state granting monies to a county, and then the county's lending the money to the business. That is the piece that they are identifying which is wrong with how the Regional Business Fund defederalized. I have a hard time finding the connection there. So the information that I provided to HUD really lays out how we defederalized, that it's very, very close to how they're now telling us how to defederalize. And we're just asking for a reprieve and not to be subject to very minor technicality.
Thank you for that great answer. And so you can also then say it has nothing to do with which businesses are being benefited one way or the other. It's solely the process.
Solely the process.
So are there any other questions? Supervisor Hansen.
Thank you. The nature of the size of the business, and this kind of is what Roy was touching on perhaps. I'm going back to the study that we had done with the impact of the bridge coming across in St. Croix County, the economic impact study, which was, I think, a 7-hour report that we had during a county board meeting. I think one of the main things that came out of that was that we need to incubate small businesses that didn't exist before. And what I'm most concerned about, I think, in this entire conversation is that we remain autonomous, even somewhat from WEDEC, because I would really hate to think that we fight for this and then have these funds taken on a state level and turn into corporate welfare. Mm-hmm. And is there assurance that that's the case, that these will continue to be for, if you look at Main Street in New Richmond, Knowles Avenue, you'll see many facades that have been renovated through the benefit of this program. Mm-hmm. And I'd love to see that continue. I'd love to see new businesses continue to grow up. But I really, and this is what Dr. Babbitt was touching on, I really get nervous about this state management. Mm-hmm. Are we going to be autonomous? Are you going to be autonomous if mm-hmm. we continue to?
We have an investment strategy which was created back in 2006 and 2007. And the beauty of it is that that is the template through which our loan programs are run. And the only way that changes can be made to our investment strategy is by a consensus of all of the 8 counties that we serve. So if there were to be a change to, let's say, our revolving loan fund program, at the board level, me in my office, I can't make those changes. What we do is we approach every single county loan committee, which has representatives from each of the communities that, consolidated the loans. We have to get their consensus before we can make any changes. So those changes are not dictated by the state or by the federal level. Now, I say that even though HUD has come in and drastically changed our program, but I would there with the regulations that I've seen, I don't see that though our loan programs would be dictated by the state, and we are a completely separate entity from WEDC. There was a time during which we reported to WEDC because they were the state oversight agency for the Community Development Block Grant Program, but they are no longer. The Department of Administration is two completely separate entities.
Any other questions? If there are no other questions, thank you, Beth, for answering questions. We have a resolution with an amendment. It's been motion made and seconded, and I'll have Cindy read back the amendment to it so that everybody knows what the amendment was. Yeah.
Okay. I wasn't quite sure if I caught all the names on the amendment. I was going to follow up with the recording. But the motion was by Ring, second by Hansen, to amend the resolution to include... Yeah.
Yep.
He's so asking for
okay
clarification.
So we're time to vote. The motion, the original motion as amended. That's what I said. And all yeses, 18 yeses on that. Thank you. Now we'll go back up to our agenda item, the annual report from Health and Human Services Department with Director Fred Johnson.
Do you think people want to take a break?
No. I don't want to take a break because I want to go home.
Yeah.
I'm not feeling well, so
okay.
They're going to have to wait. Okay?
I'll start with that I hope.
Sorry.
My first trip to the podium wasn't the best performance that you've ever seen. So with those words,
you kept it short, and that's the way we like it.
I will keep it short and sweet. First, would like to thank the County Board of Supervisors for the opportunity to provide a brief presentation tonight. And I'd also like to thank all of the Health and Human Services staff. I'm very lucky to work with such a fine group of people. I'm going to highlight from the report three things tonight, and would encourage individuals, if you have questions and you want to dig deeper into a subject matter, to feel free to contact me or any of our department managers, administrators, and we'd be happy to sit down and go through whatever detail you like. The first thing is, in 2014, we did make a move across New Richmond to our new facility. That was July 1st of 2014. I think it might be on page 3 or 4, if you're looking at me. And ultimately, that was a very successful transition. There's many people to thank. I won't go through all of that details, but many hands made that project go very smoothly, so much so that we had closed for business 2 days. We kept all of our emergency services open, obviously, but we closed for business 2 days. But on the second day, Monday, I think it was June 30th, within 2 hours of arriving at the facility, staff were already working in their flex stations due to the fine work that had been done in terms of preparation for the move, facility staff being there to get everybody situated, and of course IT. And again, I said I wouldn't mention individuals because I probably would be remiss and I'll miss somebody, but nonetheless, we got started very quickly and it was a successful move. Since then, we've also added flex stations and ability for staff to work in other areas, namely the government center here in Baldwin, and that is proving to be a great benefit as well. The second area that I'd like to just briefly highlight is finance, and that's on page 3. If you look at that graph right now, that shows about a $53,000 surplus or fund balance, if you will, and that number just within the last week or so has increased to about 200, I think it's 267,000. The reason for that is, in my estimation, one of the strategic initiatives that we took on in 2014 was working with our finance department to do better time reporting and reporting of our actual expenses to the state. Beata Haug has done a great job with her team, along with working with our program managers, to really make sure we tell the state what our true expenses are. So where did that extra $213,000 come from? At year end, there's a reconciliation process with our children's long-term support program. And if we expend all of our dollars and get into local match for slots or for services where we put up 40 cents and the federal government will put up 60 cents, if we have shown all of our expenditures, we've recorded all of that information, the state looks at everybody in this reconciliation process, and for those counties that have underspent their allocations, they will reobligate. It's a reob-deob process. So by doing better fiscal reporting and partnering well with program and finance, we're able to see some gains there. We can't control that. We can't control what other counties do or don't spend, but we can control how we manage those funds, and we, I think, do a very good job. This shows a little bit of how we would like to move forward with some of the detail that we're working on with the Health and Human Services Board to give visual graphs and charts to show more detail. I think we have a good foundation to take our monthly projections, or our quarterly projections, excuse me, and now take that to the next level and start working on how do we look from year to year and maybe develop more of a long-range plan on where we see funding moving. So we have a great team that's working on the expenditure reports and making sure we're reporting all of our expenses, and we're seeing some of those benefits. I think Beata highlighted at a Health and Human Services Board meeting that we got an extra $4,000 in, I think it was an adult protection grant. Just yesterday I got a note that there was some unexpended dollars in, I'm blanking on the name of the program, but it was about another $8,000 that will be moved to St. Croix County because other counties underspent, and we have been doing a good job of reporting our expenditures. The third area is just some strategic initiatives that I thought I would highlight. In 2015-17, that's on page 4, we've taken what the County Board of Supervisors has approved as strategic initiatives or the strategic plan, and we've broken that really into 4 primary areas: enhanced community partnerships, program development, program metrics, and operational efficiencies. So what I've asked the management team and the Health and Human Service staff to take a look at is, within those 4 categories, what should we be working on over the next 2 to 3 years, rather than taking it, and sometimes projects are short term that they may only take 3 to 6 months to do, but sometimes they're long term. And so let's make sure that we're taking time to commit to these projects and see them through to completion, rather than starting a project and ending it because there's other priorities that are determined to be more pressing. That will happen at times, but we're trying to take a longer range look. In terms of some of the work that still needs to be done in this area, where you'll see the TBD, the to be determined, is that none of us have a corner on the market on good ideas. So when you take a structure to a staff of 184 people, somebody will have a good idea that doesn't fit the mold, that these are just ideas, things that are in the process of being developed. So I'm hopeful that all of the good work that we started in 2014 that will continue into 2015 and beyond will, there'll be some sparks of brilliance from some of the folks that we work with, and they'll take this structure and run with it. There's a lot of detail in here, and again, rather than spending time going through program detail piece by piece, I'd be happy again to set up time with any one of you to answer questions and run through this report in any detail or answer questions, maybe at a later time that would allow for you to move on to the next subject matter. But if there are pressing questions, now obviously I'm here and willing to do my best to answer all of the easy questions.
Supervisor Babbitt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As chair of HHS board, I just wanted to say it's been a privilege so far to work with Fred and his staff. I think obviously HHS is a very big part of this county with a huge number of programs and a lot of staff. And Fred and his staff have made it a lot easier on me and on my vice chair, Supervisor Kiesler, and the rest of the members of the board to understand what is a very complex process. And I too would like to thank Beata Haug and her staff for the financial work that they've done. They've certainly made it a lot easier for us to get our hands on the budget, if you will, for HHS. So I just wanted to thank you, Fred, and be sure to make sure the staff hears that as well. Thanks.
Supervisor Kiesler.
I just would like to make a comment and a concern that I've already shared with Fred in terms of the report. And, you know, as a backdrop to my concern, I would say, you know, you're coming forth with yet another budget in the black. Year after year, you have shown that you can bring budgets in on or better than what's budgeted. So I don't know the exact record, Fred, but this is a compliment in terms of
I knocked on wood too.
Certainly more budgets than not, and maybe all budgets under your watch have been brought in the black. So I say that as a backdrop to my comment, and my comment is when you look at the report, my concern is the span of control in a couple of the departments look pretty large. Typically, span of control in at least incident command would be 5 to 7, right? And that's emergency situations, and you have to make snap decisions and blah blah blah. Even if you double that to a 10 to 14. Some of these departments, the span of control are up to 20, 25. And I think that can create situations at times where we're missing things, we're not able to maybe implement as many things as we could. We may not stay always on the cutting edge of development. We may not be able to address the staff needs, which may lead to at times morale issues if staff aren't feeling maybe like they're being heard. And so why I say this is I hope, or I would ask that you and the administrator would consider in the 2016 budget as we begin to prepare for that to reinvest some of these savings that you have been able to accomplish in trying to buy down, so to speak, the span of control and give some relief to the department heads and the supervisors that I think are I would say, overworked and stretched to their limit at times. And so this is all a compliment in terms of your abilities and trying to support you and your administration by adding a layer or two of management and supervision to the system, since year after year after year after year, you've come in with surpluses. And so this is a plea to you, to the administrator, and to the county board that as we look to 2016, that we reinvest some of those savings in some of those types of positions. Thanks.
I appreciate your comments, and I would just follow up quickly, if I may, County Board Chair, that embedded in this report, you'll see a program called Comprehensive Community Services, which we hope to initiate here sometime the late summer, maybe August or September at the latest. What that program does allow is an opportunity for 100% reimbursement of our costs. It's a program that really fits somewhere between your outpatient mental health or alcohol and drug abuse services and a community support program. It's probably somewhere in between somebody that may need a little more than outpatient and maybe a little less than a community support program where there's chronic mental health issues. That program is, I think, an avenue for us to look at adding staff in a management role, certainly as a staff role, to meet the needs of St. Croix County and tap into funding sources that don't tap into an already exhausted source called tax levy, where every year when we bring budgets forth, there's more, the need outstrips the availability of funds. So that is an area that we will take a look at, not only for supervisors, but for staff as well as those that support staff that are doing the work, whether it's billing and things of that nature. So I appreciate your comments, and it did not fall on deaf ears.
Any other questions for Fred? Supervisor Schoberg.
I just find it interesting that this very comprehensive report, but it doesn't appear to be any numbers of outcomes of reductions in behavioral issues or reductions in suicides or anything like that. Maybe I'm missing something, but can you state what happened in 2014 as far as incidents of alcohol crisis situations or drug abuse, overdoses, those things going on?
I probably would need time to pull specific programmatic detail like that, and would be happy to do so and get that back to you. But I think what you've hit upon is one of the areas, and if you look at this detail, it's under program metrics. I think we need to do a better job of not only identifying how many appointments and how much billable time, but how are we starting to make an impact on some of the outcomes, if you will. There is embedded in this report, I think, in one area that individuals that are involved in our community support program that are hospitalized, their rehospitalization rate is less than, you know, it's 0.08%. So it's that type of data that I would like to be able to put into the dashboards, if you will, that you saw on page 3 and 4, and do more around. I think sometimes numbers are important, how many visits and how many much productivity, but also how are we doing at a glance, if you will. And I've looked at a couple of reports, one of which is done by the Division of Juvenile Corrections, and they have a report that's a monthly at a glance, and I think it's actually very well done and maybe gets to some of the detail you're asking about. The other area that jumps to my mind right away is, how many children do we have in placement? I can't tell you the exact number, but on a per thousand basis, we're very low in comparison to potential other counties that are like size. And so starting to pull that data and be able to report outcomes of that nature, I think are next steps we need to take. And it's in the program metrics of where I think we need to spend more time and more work. But I'd be happy to run through details with you at a later time or at a different report. But point well taken.
Supervisor Ring.
So I have a question on the 2014 income maintenance recipients, and you have a count by month. So what programs, and so that's, as I understand it, you have a count of adults and children and a total. For example, January, 10,499. Is that the number of people getting, what kind of income maintenance assistance is that?
If you're referring to the chart that is on page 18, that is a chart that is referring to the number of individuals that are receiving medical assistance and food share. Income maintenance really has food share, medical assistance, energy assistance, and child care are the four primary program areas. But that graph right there is dealing with the number of recipients for medical and food share. And an interesting stat that I believe we talked about at a previous meeting, we're seeing the number of self-pay go down and the number of medical assistance pay source, if you will, go up. And that's due to the Affordable Care Act and some of the outreach work that we've done in the county that I think we've stepped up to work with our partners to make sure people are aware and access those benefits. And we're seeing it in our billing, and the self-pay is really indigent, primarily.
So I think this would be an area that, you know, if we can focus on too as a county to reduce those numbers. However, and maybe that's on how do we do that? What are the ways that we can get more self-pay opportunities? Is it jobs? What is it? I think.
Well, getting benefits to people that meet the entitlement, if you will, 100% of the federal poverty level or less, and single adults that don't have children has expanded some of the, you know, what we're seeing as terms of pay source. So in some respects, for us, that's a good thing. But in terms of the overall economy, I get it that would be something we'd want to see reductions in. And what we do locally is we do work with our food share and employment training program. They come out to our office and have time in our office in one of our interview rooms. So people that come in and not only apply for benefits, they can have access to food share and employment training programs. We would be glad to partner with anybody to give access and availability for our program recipients to work with other providers that may help them work towards gainful employment.
So it just surprises me. It's about 10%, and if 10% of our population.
Yes, it is about 10%. You're right.
Thanks.
Any other questions, Supervisor Babbitt?
Just two quick things to address Supervisor Schoberg's concerns, and he may be well aware of this, but there are a number of initiatives underway in St. Croix County to deal with the suicide issue. One of them being headed up by our medical examiner, Patty Schachner, but there are several different groups working more and more together to try to reduce the suicide numbers. And the county is involved at least in several different ways with those initiatives. The other thing has to do with alcohol and drug-related issues and the detox question, and this could take up a great deal of time, which we won't take tonight, but there are no detox facilities in St. Croix County. And it's a huge problem for the local hospitals who have to deal with those cases when they appear in the emergency departments. I know that Fred and Supervisor Kiesler and others are involved in some processes to take a look at that and see what we can do to try to provide better service for that particular population, which is something I think as a county we need to be concerned about, but we're obviously working with community partners as well to try to address those questions. And Fred, I don't know if you would add anything to that particularly, but.
The only thing I would add is the Health and Human Services Board at the last meeting in May approved to our department to work with community partners to proceed with a zero suicide grant that we're one of maybe 10 counties that are eligible. And if we get the grant, it could be as much as $100,000 a year that is, I understand it at this point, without a lot of detail from the state at this point, is it wouldn't necessarily require match funds, may not necessarily even be a Health and Human Services employee, but an initiative that we have staff working on. So important stuff to, you know, address issues within the community, not only as a Health and Human Services department, but with our community partners. And that really may be a good way to wrap this up in terms of our mission statement or our vision statement, and that is quality health and human services for everyone by everyone. We know we don't do this work alone. And so we rely on, and one of our initiatives is to work with our community partners to bring that those services to folks that are in need, whether it's helping them find employment and partnering with agencies to provide space, or work on addressing suicide issues that have been a concern in our community for sure.
Any other questions? None? Thank you, Mr. Thank you. Johnson, for that. We'll move on to our administrator's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just briefly, the monthly financials are in your board packet, representing expenditures and revenues through the end of April of this year. Total budgeted expenditures of $82.3 million. We're at 25% of budget after 4 months of the year. Same amount, $82.3 million in revenues. We're at 47% of budget for revenues, which is good at this point of the year. The 2014 total expenditures, unaudited, the auditors are in the process now of going through 2014 of a little over $75 million in total expenses and revenues of $75.4 million. So revenues exceeding expenditures, at least at this point, unaudited numbers. So things are okay financially at this point, and I don't know if you have specific questions. Mr. Middet is here, but otherwise, that's it for my report.
Are there any questions? None? Thank you. We'll thank you for your report.
Yeah.
We'll move on to our next business item, which is the resolution approving the county administrator's 7-1-2014 to 2-28-2015 pay performance assessment and goals for 3-1-15 to 2-28-2016. Supervisor Schottner makes a motion. Do I have a second? Seconded by Supervisor Schoberg. Discussion? Any Supervisor Akhtarov?
I just have, because five goals is a lot, I personally think. And one thing I'm going to throw out is, and I'm not saying it's not important, but number four, which is continue to measure and obtain increases in employee morale, that should be an ongoing process, and I believe it is an ongoing process. And for us to continuously have surveys year after year after year, I think if we had one every 3 to 5 years, it may be more informative. And we're doing a lot of stuff this year, and I don't know how, when we would do the survey and how much would actually be in the survey and how valid the survey would be. So in my opinion, it'd be nice to not include number four, not that we would not be doing anything in that area, but it would not be one of, it would bring the goals down to four, which is still kind of high. I think you're perfectly capable, so, you know. But that is my opinion, that I would like to remove goal number four.
You want to amend the resolution?
I'd like to amend the resolution to remove goal number four.
Do I have a second to that? You'll second that? Supervisor Schottner seconds it? So,
then
so.
I'll speak against the motion to amend. I was a member of the, am a member of the administration committee, and yes, five is more than adequate, but our administrator said he was up to the task, and it's not too far in our past that we really wrestled hard with this employee morale issue. It was one of the main reasons I ran for this office, and at least for a couple years running in a row, at least until I'm out of this office, I'd like it to be present on our goals. And so I would continue to support its presence.
Supervisor Hanson.
I'd like to speak against the amendment as well. Our administrator is extraordinarily capable, and I often will substitute the idea of administrator with the idea of delegator, and Patrick has a very fine-tuned ability to know who to delegate to, hold accountable, and get results. Five goals is easily within his grasp. Also, in terms of the morale issue, because our staff do not have the legal right to collectively bargain, I think it's critical that we take the pulse of the morale, because they don't have the right to organize and bargain based on their own morale. They don't, in other words, their collective sense of what is right for their situation in the county. And it's another tool, a very important tool that we can use to pace what our associates, our employees, feel is right and wrong with how we're doing business. So I speak against the amendment.
Any other discussion? Supervisor Schroeder.
I guess I'll say why I am for this amendment. It comes down to three simple points. The first is I agree completely that there's just too many goals. I would have preferred to see cut down to three, but it's hard to figure out which one of the others I would really cut out. To me, it's a priority thing. We have been doing this. We need to let the dust settle and then take a survey. To constantly take a survey over and over again, all you're doing is hammering it home that it was bad and keep looking back. If we want our employees to look forward, we need to let them get used to the system and then ask. That would be reason number two. And for the third reason, I have no doubt that our administrator could complete all these goals, but what it really comes down to is I took some words that he had said about the implementation of the three-year plan for the budget, and he had a concern about that because we don't have an interim, or we only have an interim finance director right now. So a concern was, well, if you get somebody new in, that could change everything up. That was a concern of yours. And I think that concern is a bigger concern when we're talking about employee morale, because we have no HR director. We have an interim HR director. No. Oh, no. We don't even have an interim HR director. So if he was to delegate this task, that person is getting less and less time to do this task, because that would be who is doing this. And we're just starting the process of looking at what we want in the new director for HR. So considering that the person coming in who would be actually implementing this would be on a relatively short schedule if we approve it today, considering that it'll be a lot shorter for them to implement it, I think the best time to do, if we were to do this, the best time would be in the next cycle and not this cycle, just due to staffing that's already being overworked.
Supervisor Nelson.
I'm going to vote against the amendment because I really think that it's important in the public sector that you gauge employees' morale, because a lot of the employees are the first face of what a lot of people see. And I can also see is when he does a measure of how employees are doing, it's probably tied into paid for performance. So that's a huge morale thing too. So he needs to gauge how the employee morale is in accordance to how the paid for performance program is working. Because I firmly don't feel that a paid for performance in this setting is working, and hopefully he'll have the tools on the surveys to do it for another year or two to see how the employee morale is if we change this form of how people are being paid instead of using pay for performance. I would vote against the amendment.
Supervisor Berkey.
I would like to also vote against the amendment. I'm on the administration committee, and we had extensive discussion about what the objectives would be in the evaluation of the administrator and what his goals would be. He's goal-oriented. I feel that he's capable of this. I think, too, in terms of the timing, we have the McGrath study that's currently being done, and I think it's important that we do have the timeliness and a measurable tool that is part of the administrator's performance criteria. And then to point out that this actually is up through the end of February next year. So we do have some time. Thank you.
Yeah, Supervisor Novotny.
I'm just curious, when was the last survey of this type done?
I think we did an employee engagement survey in 2014.
Okay, so this would be an annual survey that we're talking about?
We usually try to survey the employees after the pay for performance cycle completes, which we're just completing that now. And I think the staff advisory committee is looking at doing an engagement survey probably this fall.
How long is the survey typically?
Well, it's fairly short, okay. And it's all online.
The reason I ask is, in my other life, I get involved with surveys very frequently. I hope my bosses aren't watching. But they can become tedious and irritating. And sometimes a little vague. So I am not in favor of frequent surveys. And I don't know whether annual is too much. Unless you've got a program that you're measuring, you may want to go to every 2 years.
I think eventually we may get there. I think it's important just to keep finger on the pulse of the organization. We've gone through a lot of changes, and I think what's most important about these surveys is that employees know that it's a valuable use of their time, because we listen, we respond to the surveys, we take the suggestions that are made, those that are constructive anyway, and we try to make improvements. We have made several improvements to the pay-for-performance system based on feedback that we've gotten from our surveys, and we've made some other policy and organizational changes based on feedback from surveys. And so I think employees know that we take them seriously, and we do respond, and we try to make improvements based on the feedback. The surveys themselves are pretty, they're not onerous, and it's one that employees can fill out anonymously. And so the information that's collected is kept in a database, and it's reviewed by the human resources staff along with the administration and ultimately the administration committee. And we try to make improvements based on what information we get. So I think they're useful, but I agree with you that I think we should probably get to the point where we're surveying maybe every other year.
Thank you.
Any other discussion on this amendment?
So we're already planning on implementing a survey.
I know the staff advisory committee has talked about this. They don't have the survey instrument completed yet, so it's in discussion.
And if this wasn't a goal of yours, would you fight against doing that?
If this wasn't a goal, I think I said to the committee that every single decision I make is geared, although it may not be construed that way, but it's to try to help improve the workforce, yeah, and to try to increase morale and improve morale. So for me, I don't need for it to be a written goal for it to be part of what I do. But I agree with Supervisor Schoberg that it's a statement of priority for the board. And so I think there's no harm in it being a written goal. But if it were not a written goal, would it not be on my radar screen? No. It's permanently etched on my radar screen.
I guess my point is that goals have an end, and to put continue, have a continuous goal that could just roll over every year, that's not a goal. So that's why it's, if this wasn't one of your goals, it would still be on your agenda of things to do.
Yes.
So.
Any other discussion on the amendment? There's none. The amendment is to remove number 4 from the resolution, which is continue to measure and obtain increase in employee morale. We can vote on that now. And that amendment failed. So now we're back to the original amendment, the original resolution. We have a motion, a second on the floor. Is there any further discussion on the resolution? If there is none, are we ready to vote? Yes. Supervisor, we need a second. We have 18 yeses. Thank you. We have this time we'll look for a request for future agenda items. Is there anything out there that somebody wants on the agenda for next month? Raise your hands. Nelson? Nelson.
Can we get an update on where we're at with the security screening? I watched admin on TV the other night, so they got a little bit of an update, but kind of see where we're at in the process.
Yeah, we can do that.
It doesn't have to be super elaborate, but kind of see where we're at and hopefully kind of maybe get some of these comments or things that have been made maybe be kind of cleansed a little bit to make sure, you know, we're doing the right thing.
Any other agenda items that anybody would like to see on? If not, I think we'll move on. We've got Cindy, our county clerk. Any correspondence or?
I have no correspondence. I do have a couple of announcements. Okay. I passed a card around. Leon Bernscott, he was a former county board member, passed away yesterday. He served for about 10 years on the county board and more recently served on as a citizen member on Health and Human Services. So just to let you know that. And the new directories are printed and have been distributed. And although my name appears on the front of it, Amy did the work, so I have to give her credit for that. Another announcement, a WCA annual conference. If you're interested, please let me know. The deadline to register at the discounted rate is August 7th. However, first-term supervisors have a free registration yet, and it's in La Crosse, September 20th through the 22nd. I think that's all I have.
Okay. So. Thank you. Any other I'm just asked for announcements. No.
Congratulations to Supervisor Anderson, who was received the Volunteer of the Year for the Hammond Nursing Home. So congratulations, Supervisor Anderson.
Any other announcements, Supervisor Nielsen?
My wife and I have sold our home and we'll be moving. And we're not moving far, but we are moving outside of Supervisory District 6, and therefore we'll be resigning my position. Will be effective on June 5th, on Friday. I'll come in next week, Cindy, if I can, and turn in my badge and clean up any loose ends, if there are any. It's been a joy getting to know all of you. I appreciate the respect that you've shown me. And Pat, if you would pass on to the many county employees that I have met and worked with, and thank them and express my appreciation. If nothing else, in the last year and a half, I have gotten to know and gotten to appreciate the hard work and the dedication of many of the employees of the county. So I thank you. I plan on staying involved, but as a member of public, so I'm sure that you will be seeing me in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Announcements?
I have an announcement.
Berkey, yes.
Prior to the county fair, as you know, I'm all on the fair board, there is a fundraiser, the rodeo, the annual rodeo, which will be held June 20th at the county fairgrounds. I meant to bring those posters to Cindy to get in everybody's op box, but I'll do that kind of after the fact and probably ask Cindy to scan it and send that out to everyone too. It's a fun event. I went last year. And kids are involved, adults. It's where it's at the fair.
Grounds.
Thank you. Any other announcements? If there are none, we are adjourned. Thank you, everyone.